Okay, let me start by thanking the organizers to ask me to speak at this wonderful meeting about an approach to quantum gravity. So in the spectrum that we have in this meeting between observations and theory, of course, unfortunately, quantum gravity is very much on the theoretical end of the spectrum. So what I will try to do in this talk is to give you a non-technical, at least I hope it will be a non-technical introduction to the asymptotic safety scenario. So that's a particular approach to quantum gravity, where the recent years have seen quite a bit of, I think, exciting progress, and I'll try to give you a bit of an idea of what has happened. And then I actually have two main goals for this talk. So first of all, my goal is to set the stage for two further talks that will explore consequences of asymptotic safety for the topic of this workshop, namely the talk by Alessia Platania later this afternoon on cosmic censorship in asymptotic safety, and a talk by Frank Sauer-Essig on Thursday on cosmic perturbations from asymptotic safety. And since the two of them will cover consequences for black holes, for singularities, and for cosmology, that gives me the freedom to actually bring a slightly different aspect into the discussion as well, because as you see in my title, I'm emphasizing that this is an approach not just to quantum space-time, but also to matter. So in the last bit of my talk, I would like to emphasize that if we are thinking about the fundamental quantum structure of space-time, in my view, it's actually important to not only think about actually the dynamics, the fundamental dynamics of space-time, but also include the fact that in our universe we clearly have matter degrees of freedom. So the starting point of this talk, and by the way, feel free to interrupt with questions or comments during any point. So the starting point will be singularities. As in the title of the workshop, of course, we have singularities in general relativity that just signal the need to go beyond general relativity. We also have another type of singularities occurring in sort of the second pillar of modern theoretical physics, namely in particle physics. So here the singularities that we have are because our description of particle physics is a quantum description, so we have quantum fluctuations, and quantum fluctuations drive a scale dependence of couplings. And what happens in some of the sectors of the standard model is that they drive some of these couplings to divergences, and as just in the case of singularities in GR, whenever we have a singularity in our physical description, that basically signals a breakdown of the model and tells us that we need to go beyond. And so both of our pillars of our modern understanding of the universe are incomplete in certain regimes, and I would like to argue that what we need is actually to bring both of these together in some way. So our fundamental description of space-time, we generically expect that singularities will be resolved by taking into account quantum effects, so we need to marry GR to quantum field theory. And on the other hand, I would like to argue that to resolve the singularities that we have in the standard model of particle physics and to really obtain a fundamental description of matter as well, we should actually include quantum gravity into the picture. And so this brings me to this goal. So what I would like to understand is the path integral for quantum gravity and matter. So the path integral is the object where we extract observables from in a quantum field theory. And it, of course, takes into account not just the classical field configuration, but all possible field configurations of the metric and of all matter fields, if you include them. And, of course, every field configuration is weighted by a complex phase factor. And so, of course, in this setting, we're not just taking into account classical field configurations, we are taking into account all quantum fluctuations, and they can have really important consequences. So the effect of quantum fluctuations is that coupling constants that we are used to as thinking of as taking constant values in classical physics, that they start to exhibit a scale dependence. And that is particularly intuitive in the case of, for instance, quantum electrodynamics. So in that case, you can think of quantum fluctuations just as electron-positron pairs that pop out of the vacuum and disappear again. Now, of course, when you have a charge sitting there and you have these electron-positron pairs around it, and then you look at the charge with a certain resolution scale, so k here is a momentum scale, 1 over k you can think of as a length scale, a resolution scale. So if you look at that chart with a certain resolution scale, then the effect of quantum fluctuations is to actually screen the value of that charge. So the quantum vacuum is actually not a trivial empty vacuum at all. in the case of quantum electrodynamics, for instance, it starts to behave like a screening medium. So that means as you start to zoom in closer and you start to understand the more fundamental structure, as you go towards higher scales, you will see an increasing value of the charge. Now, in a cosmological setting or in a general, in a gravitational setting, you're probably used to thinking of the Newton coupling as just being a constant, constant value, right? It's called the Newton constant. But what happens in a quantum gravitational setting is that quantum fluctuations of the metric, in the same way as quantum fluctuations of the metafields in the standard model, they will drive a scale dependence of the gravitational coupling. And so what we would like to understand is what is the scale dependence of the gravitational coupling that is induced by quantum fluctuations, and therefore what is the microscopic dynamics of gravity as you take into account quantum fluctuations. So in the case, so what we now do have to understand is that if we have a running scale-dependent Newton coupling, we would like to understand how does it behave as we go towards higher and higher energies. And for that, I would just like to briefly review the different cases of high energy behavior that we can encounter in quantum field theory. So one very important paradigm that governs a large part of particle physics is, of course, asymptotic freedom. So what we have here is the strong coupling, so the coupling in quantum chromodynamics. And you can see a plot of the coupling as a function of the momentum scale. And this red curve in the background, that's the theoretical prediction. And then you can see the data, the most recent ones from CMS, falling beautifully on top. And clearly one of the most important messages of this plot is that the interaction strength in the strong interactions is not a constant coupling, but in fact it's a running scale-dependent coupling, and it decreases as you go towards higher and higher scales. And so as you extrapolate this plot, something really interesting happens, because you can already see that the interaction strength actually decreases as you go towards higher and higher energies. And so asymptotically, you will reach a regime where the coupling strength simply vanishes. And you can also see, if you look at this plot, that the speed of the running becomes lower and lower as you go towards higher scales. So the magnitude of the scale dependence becomes weaker as you go towards higher scales. And so asymptotically, what you reach is actually a regime where you become scale invariant. And this will actually be a key point also for what I come to later. So in contrast to this setting and the fact that we can go to very, very high energies here without running into any divergences, that actually means that in principle, quantum chromodynamics or quarks and gluons are really viable microscopic degrees of freedom. And we encounter a completely different behavior in the case of quantum electrodynamics, where, as I said previously, vacuum fluctuations, quantum fluctuations in the vacuum have the effect of leading to a running of the electric charge that increases as a function of scale. And what happens at a finite scale is that you encounter a so-called Landau pole, or beyond perturbation theory, this is known as the triviality problem. Physically, what it means is that there is a scale at which this description of physics, the interaction of photons with charges in terms of quantum electrodynamics, that description breaks down at that scale, and this is the scale where new physics has to enter the picture. Now, there's a third possibility that hasn't been... first of all, let me just briefly mention that this problem, the fact that we encounter a Landau pole, that affects two different sectors of the standard model of particle physics, namely the U1 hypercharge sector, that's what becomes QED at lower scales, and also since 2012, since we know that the Higgs exists, we know that there is also a similar problem in the Higgs sector if we go to very, very high scales. And so today we understand the standard model not as a fundamental description of matter, but as an effective theory that holds over a finite range of scales and breaks down as we go to really high energies. Actually very similar to the case of GR, which we would say is an effective theory that works extremely well and beautifully over a huge range of scales, but that breaks down as we go to very, very small scales. Now, as I advertised previously, there's a third possibility for the high energy behavior in quantum field theories, and that is known as asymptotic safety. And this will really be the important scenario for the case of gravity. So what happens here is that quantum fluctuations start driving a scale dependence of a running coupling, And for instance, it might start increasing as a function of scale, but then there is a special value of the coupling at which quantum fluctuations balance against each other so that you can actually reach a scale invariant regime up here at a finite value of the coupling. And of course, once you have reached a regime where quantum fluctuations lead to a scale invariant regime, that actually means you can zoom into arbitrary small scales without encountering any divergences like that. And that means you can really understand the fundamental microscopic dynamics of space-time. It's given by the scale invariant regime, and the dynamics is given by these values of the couplings that are assumed in the scale invariant regime. So you can see that in some sense this is similar to the case of asymptotic freedom. The key is that in both cases you reach a scale invariant regime where the coupling just approaches a constant value at very high scales, and this is what allows us to make these into fundamental quantum field theories. The difference between asymptotic freedom and asymptotic safety is only that in the case of asymptotic freedom, the scale invariant regime lies at vanishing interactions, whereas it lies at a finite value of the couplings in the case of asymptotic safety. And what I will be exploring in this talk, and what Alessia and Frank will be exploring the consequences of, is the question whether the coupling in gravity, the Newton coupling, actually exhibits a behavior like that and becomes asymptotically safe. What this would actually imply is that then we could have a quantum field theoretic description really of the fundamental quantum structure of space-time, so we would finally succeed in including gravity into the set of interactions that can be described by quantum field theory. So, of course, ideally what we would like to do is to just do the similar thing to the case of asymptotic freedom, the case of QCD, just tell the experimentalists to please run an accelerator and extract the scale dependence of the running coupling from that. But, of course, in the case of gravity, the scale at which we expect quantum fluctuations of gravity to really become important and have a sizable impact is in the vicinity of the Planck scale. In particle physics units, 10 to the 16 GeV, which means it's 10 to the 12 orders of magnitude above the LHC. And so most likely this is not going to happen anytime soon. We can't probe the running of the Newton coupling yet. Yet is possibly an optimistic statement. So therefore, what we do at the moment is to explore this as a theoretical concept and explore whether such a behavior actually comes out of calculations for the quantum field theoretic calculations for the scale dependence of the Newton coupling. And of course, in a later step, we will then try to see whether a behavior like that is actually consistent with observations, possibly, for instance, of early universe cosmology. So let me briefly highlight the technique that we use to do that, and I will be very brief on that, and I will just try to give you the main gist of the method that we are using. So what we are using is the functional renormalization group. Basically, you can think of that as the mathematical version of a microscope, so it allows us to zoom in on quantum space-time and evaluate the value of couplings as a function of a sort of resolution scale. So the functional renormalization group allows to probe the scale dependence of a quantum field theory. The way we do that is we introduce an effective dynamics encoded in this effective action that depends on the scale k. K is something like an inverse resolution scale, and this effective dynamics contains the effect of quantum fluctuations at high scales. And so it interpolates between the regime where all quantum fluctuations are integrated out. This is what the classical regime is, where classical general relativity has to come back out of the setting. And on the other hand, if you take the momentum scale k to infinity, you're really zooming into arbitrary small distance scales. This is where we are looking at the microscopic dynamics, and we are hoping to discover this UV scale invariant regime, where the scale-dependent Newton coupling becomes constant in this way. Just very briefly, technically, the way that we do that is we take the standard path integral and we modify it by a term that you can think of as a term that dials the sort of resolution scale of our microscope. Basically, in more technical terms, it's an infrared regulator term that you can think of as scale and momentum dependent mass. It allows us to sort quantum fluctuations in the path integral so that only the high energy quantum fluctuations are integrated out and the low energy quantum fluctuations follow further. And in this way, if we change this resolution scale, we step by step take into account the effect of quantum fluctuations from very high scales to very very low scales. And in this way, we can extract the scale dependence of running couplings. Basically, this whole thing is encoded in the Wetterich equation, and I will not explain any more details about this. Just that technically, this is similar to the evaluation of Feynman loop diagrams. So this is allows us to actually apply sort of standard quantum field theoretic tools to the case of quantum gravity. And what we do with that is extract the scale dependence of the Newton coupling. And this is what you get out of this machinery. So here I'm looking at the Anton-Hilbert action with a Newton coupling and a cosmological constant. Both of them aren't constant anymore. Both of them depend on the scale, and this is indicated by the dependence on k here. What we actually then do is that we look at dimensionless versions of these two couplings by just multiplying them with powers of the momentum scale k. We're looking at these dimensionless versions of the coupling because, remember, we are interested in discovering a scale invariant regime. And so then you get out plots like this, where these little arrows show the scale dependence towards the infrared. So if I give you the values of the couplings at any particular scale, then this lands you somewhere in this plot, and then these arrows take you, show you where you get taken to as you go towards lower scales as you zoom out. And so remember, what we are really interested in is understanding what happens as we zoom into arbitrary high momenta. And you can see there's a special point up here in the plot where the scale dependence vanishes. And so this actually is an indication for the existence of such a scale invariant regime, for the existence of asymptotic safety in quantum gravity. The second important question that you can ask once you have evaluated the scale dependence of the Newton coupling and cosmological constant is, well, if we really have such a scale invariant regime, such an asymptotically safe regime at very high momentum scales, can we actually connect that back to gravity as we know it at low scales? So starting from these particular fixed point values, can we actually go back to gravity classically with the value of the Newton coupling and the cosmological constant as it has been measured? And this is actually possible along one of those trajectories here. Down here, you actually encounter a long regime where gravity just behaves completely classically. And so this means that from these calculations here, there's hints that gravity becomes asymptotically safe, and this asymptotically safe regime can be connected smoothly to gravity as we know it at large scales in our universe. That's actually not the whole story. Quantum fluctuations of gravity not only drive a scale dependence of the Newton coupling and cosmological constant, they have a second effect. They actually generate additional terms in the microscopic dynamics. And so this means the microscopic dynamics of gravity isn't just described by the Einstein-Hilbert action, it's described by additional terms. So it has higher order curvature terms, r squared, r mu squared, and so on. So basically what we're looking for is such an asymptotically safe point in the space of all of these couplings. Of course, there are infinitely many of these. This setting still has a finite number of free parameters, and therefore predictivity if there's a finite number of UV attractive directions, and then all of the other couplings are actually predictions of asymptotic safety. And so here I will give you a lightning review of some of the results that have been obtained in the last years. So different tests of asymptotic safety in this space of couplings have been performed, taking into account different terms in the effective dynamics. First of all, higher powers in the curvature scalar, but also more complicated tensor structures. And the upshot from all of these calculations is that such an asymptotically safe point that provides you a microscopic description of quantum spacetime, it exists in all of these different approximations. And let me also highlight that some of these terms are, of course, terms that we know well from perturbative approaches to quantum gravity, where they come out as the counterterms in a perturbative treatment. And of course, you might worry that these counterterms, which in a perturbative treatment lead to a breakdown of predictivity, that they could be dangerous in the setting here. And that's actually not the case. So including the terms that are the perturbative counterterms doesn't actually lead to a problem here. And so I would like to summarize the status of the viability of asymptotic safety in gravity by saying that there are actually compelling hints for the existence of such a scale invariant regime. Of course, this doesn't necessarily mean that quantum space-time in our universe is really described by asymptotic safety. It actually means that asymptotic safety could be a consistent possibility. So clearly what we need now is to be able to extract predictions from the setup, which we then compare to possible observations. One thing that I think might be interesting to discuss in the context of this workshop is that, of course, now that gravitational waves have been detected, we are all eagerly awaiting observational constraints on modifications of gravity, for instance, on the existence of such higher powers of the curvature from the gravitational wave observations, which would be one possible way to put constraints on these couplings that are present in asymptotic safety. Now, let me briefly highlight the question of, well, now that we have these scale-dependent couplings in gravity, and they reach a UV scale invariant regime, what should I think about as the sort of structure of quantum spacetime? So what does quantum spacetime look like at small scales? And here there are actually intriguing hints for something that has been called dynamical dimensional reduction. So this has to do with the fact that dimension isn't necessarily something that stays constant. Dimension could be something, the dimension of space-time could be something that changes as you zoom into smaller scales. Now, how would you possibly probe such a thing in a Gedanken experiment? Well, one way would be to take a fictitious diffusing particle and imagine that this particle just diffuses around space-time and in that way probes the properties of space-time. You can clearly imagine that if you have just the particle doing a random walk on a classical spacetime, it will, of course, be sensitive to issues like the dimension or the topology of that spacetime. And so what you can do is you can extract dimensionality from just this random walk. Basically, you just look at the standard diffusion equation, and from that you can evaluate the return probability of the particle to its starting point, and from that return probability you get some. You get out, by taking a logarithmic derivative, you get out a number that you can call the spectral dimension. Why is it called the dimension? Well, it's called the dimension because it agrees with the topological dimension of that space-time. So this diffusing particle effectively measures the dimension of space-time. Now let's perform this Gedanken experiment in the quantum gravity regime. And here the key idea by Martin Reuter and Oliver Lauscher was to encode scale invariants that we encounter in asymptotic safety in the diffusion equation. And you can do that and then arrive at a quantum gravity-inspired diffusion equation. And let me not give you any of the technical details, just say that this equation is straightforward to solve, and you can then extract the spectral dimension in the quantum gravity regime. And if you compare these two numbers, they clearly are not the same. So starting from a spacetime that is four-dimensional at large scales, as you zoom in further and further, you're encountering a regime where quantum gravity leads to a spontaneous reduction in the dimensionality to just two dimensions. And this is actually something that appears to be a common theme in quantum gravity. So it hasn't just been seen within asymptotic safety, it has also been seen in other approaches to quantum gravity. And so I would say that probably none of the approaches to quantum gravity that are explored at the moment have got it fully right yet. Probably many of us have sort of some aspect right, but we need to combine ideas from different models to really get a proper description of quantum gravity. But what we are seeing here is that one and the same result comes out from all of these different directions. And I would take that as a possible hint that this dimensional reduction to two dimensions is something that is really, in some sense, a true property of quantum gravity. And of course, then it becomes interesting to think of possible observational consequences. So the more of the possible consequences of this microscopic structure of space-time that I've discussed here, this scale-invariant asymptotically safe regime, will be explored in the two talks by Alessia and by Frank. And I would now like to switch gears a little bit and talk about asymptotic safety of gravity and matter for the remaining 5 or so minutes before the questions. So far I've talked about the dynamics of quantum space-time. I've just talked about quantum gravity, and I've left matter completely aside. But of course, matter is a clearly very important component of our universe. And the question is there actually any non-trivial interplay between quantum gravity dynamics or matter dynamics? And I would like to argue that there is, and that if we want to think about questions like singularity resolution in quantum gravity, we should better take into account the existence of matter. So the interplay between quantum gravity dynamics and matter dynamics is twofold. First of all, matter can actually destroy, in principle, a consistent quantum gravity model. So in the setting of asymptotic safety, quantum fluctuations of gravity induce such an asymptotically safe regime. But the question is, once we take into account quantum fluctuations of matter, does this regime actually persist? And here the upshot is that matter actually matters. So matter dynamics can destroy an asymptotically safe regime in gravity. And for that, let me actually review a little bit more about where asymptotic safety comes from. So if you look at the scale dependence of the Newton coupling, then there are a variety of contributions to it. It's one from canonical scaling, and there's a term from quantum fluctuations, which you can basically think of as integrating out graviton loops, and observe that these two terms come with two different signs. And this is what allows you to give a balance and get an asymptotically safe regime. Now, if you include the effect of matter fluctuations, then there are scalar fluctuations in the standard model. These are basically the Higgs. There are fluctuations of fermions, quarks, and leptons within the standard model, and fluctuations of vectors, which are basically the gauge bosons. And the critical information here is just that these signs for the scalars and fermions differ from the fluctuations of gravity. So what this means that if you have too many scalars or fermions, then the scale invariant asymptotically safe regime that you have from the effect of quantum gravity fluctuations, that scale invariant regime can be destroyed. So I should emphasize that these results are obtained within a particular approximation where we are not taking into account all the higher order curvature terms. But what we see here is that if we fix the number of vectors to 12, so this is the number of vector particles we have in the standard model, then you see that only within these gray islands does an asymptotically safe regime of gravity exist. If you go out of these islands, the effect of quantum fluctuations of matter is to destroy the asymptotically safe regime of gravity. And so this means that even if in principle asymptotic safety is consistent for pure gravity, it can't automatically be realized in any universe. It depends on the number of matter fields that you have there. Now, crucially for the standard model matter content, we observe that it lies right within this island here. And so it appears that the standard model matter content is compatible with asymptotically safe quantum gravity. And in quantum gravity, of course, it's really difficult to make contact with observations. But what we have here is actually an observational consistency test. We have observed the existence of standard model matter at low energies. And so if this cannot be accommodated in our quantum gravity model, then of course this means that that particular quantum gravity model is ruled out. And asymptotic safety actually passes this observational consistency test. Now, this brings me to this second part of the interplay between quantum gravity and matter dynamics, namely the question whether quantum gravity fluctuations can generate a viable UV completion for matter. And this brings me back to the beginning of my talk, where I said the starting point here is singularities, not just the singularities that we have in GR, but also the singularities that we have in the standard model, where we get divergences in the standard model couplings. And the question, of course, is here whether when you go beyond the Planck scale, where quantum fluctuations of gravity become important, whether you can then induce a scale invariant regime for the matter couplings, and therefore whether asymptotic safety can at the same time provide you an ultraviolet completion for the standard model. And here I would just like to give you a brief summary of things that have been done so far in the different sectors of the standard model. For instance, in the Higgs sector, there's quite an intriguing result. So it appears that quantum gravity generates a fixed point for the Higgs sector. And from that, you can actually derive a scenario, as has been done in 2009, so 3 years before the actual Higgs discovery, which allows you to extract a prediction for the Higgs mass from asymptotic safety. And the actual value that you get is actually slightly above 126, so slightly above the measured value, but actually not too far away from that. Then also in the Yukawa sector, we find that there's a quantum gravity induced fixed point, and this one is again quite interesting because this fixed point in the Yukawa regime can only be connected to the observed value of the top mass for a restricted range of values for the quantum gravity dynamics. And so here again, we're putting observational constraints from the matter sector. We can put observational constraints on the microscopic dynamics of space-time. And finally, what I would like to highlight within the last 2 or 3 minutes is recent work that I did together with my postdoc, Nick Christiansen, on the question whether the divergence in the U1 hypercharge sector, this triviality problem that we encountered there, whether that can be solved by quantum gravity fluctuations. So here I'm talking about an asymptotically safe solution to the U1 triviality problem, and if such a solution exists, then this means that this sector of the standard model would actually become ultraviolet complete under the effect of quantum gravity. And what we have found is the following. Quantum gravity gives a contribution to the running charge in the U1 sector. And basically what you can see here is that as soon as gravity enters the scale invariant fixed point regime, it also induces a different behavior in the running charge. In particular, what it does, it induces asymptotic freedom for the running charge. So that is the first effect of quantum gravity on photons. So the effect is to induce asymptotic freedom in that sector, but there's actually slightly more that I would just like to very briefly highlight. Because asymptotic safety also has the intriguing consequence to induce new matter interactions at very high energies. In particular, it induces photon-photon interactions at very high energies, basically just by quantum gravity fluctuations. What this means is that in the microscopic dynamics, quantum gravity adds higher order field strength terms. So it's not just the field strength squared term that you know from electrodynamics, it's also a higher order term. So basically, quantum gravity generates photon-photon interactions in the UV. And let me just briefly explain that what happens under the effect of quantum gravity is that we find that quantum gravity cannot become too strong, because if quantum gravity fluctuations become too strong, they actually lead to divergences in the matter sector, they lead to divergences in the photon interactions. And so what we come up here is what we've called a weak gravity bound. It means that quantum gravity is restricted by the existence of matter. Because quantum gravity itself appears to become asymptotically safe in all the truncations that, or the approximations that we've tested. But what happens as we include matter is we see that quantum gravity actually leads to new divergences in the matter sector if it is too strong. So an observationally viable model of quantum gravity has to be sufficiently weak. Whether this weak gravity bound here has any relation to the weak gravity bound in string theory remains to be investigated. Let me just say that this observational consistency constraint is actually fulfilled in all the approximations that have been tested so far. And let me now come to my summary. So I've switched gears quite a bit from the previous talks and talked about something that is a much more theoretical study so far, namely the asymptotic safety scenario for quantum gravity and matter, and I tried to convey the main idea of that, which is that quantum fluctuations generate a scale dependence in the gravitational couplings, and that if they induce an asymptotically safe regime, then that gives us a quantum field theoretic description of quantum of space-time. I've also highlighted one of the consequences of this scenario, namely that there are hints for dynamical dimensional reduction in the ultraviolet. And finally, the second point that I made is that if we are thinking about the structure of quantum space-time, about questions like singularity resolution, for instance, in the interior of black holes or in the early universe, then we should take into account the existence of matter in our universe, because matter actually matters for the microscopic dynamics of space-time. And also, at the same time, quantum gravity can have an impact on the matter dynamics and solve the problem that the standard model isn't a ultraviolet complete theory. Possibly, quantum gravity effects could induce an ultraviolet completion for the standard model. So thank you very much for your attention.